Pavan Sukhdev, president of WWF International. He's a scientist by education, an international banker by training, and an environmental economist by passion. Years of work in sustainability and the invisible economics of nature led to his appointment to the head of the United Nations Green Economy Initiative and to lead the G8 plus 5 study team, the economies of ecosystems of biodiversity. I have personally, in my previous life, had a chance to work with both of these initiatives. In his book, Corporation 2020, he describes four changes in micropolicy and regulation, which can rapidly transform today's corporation to deliver tomorrow's green and equitable economy of permanence. As a founder of the CEO and CEO of the GIST Advisory, his sustainability consultant firm, Pava works with C-suite executives and senior government officials on transition techniques with an emphasis on metrics. GIST launched two platforms for corporate sustainability at Davos 2020 for large corporations and a simpler version for SMEs in partnership with the International Chamber of Commerce. Pavan is a goodwill ambassador of the UN environment, promoting team implementation and green economy transitions. He has served on the boards of Conservation International, the Global Reporting Initiative, the Stockholm Resilience Center, and the TIV Advisory Board. And as indicated before, he currently serves as president of WW International. The focus of the conference today is on opportunities and how to scale up investment in biodiversity. Pavan in particular will speak to us on some of the challenges and opportunities of investing in biodiversity. Due to previous commitments and time difference, he currently is in India, we have a pre-recorded video from Pavan Sukhdev. Following the video, we will move on to panel six. Please, colleagues, go ahead with the video from Pavan.
Greetings to everyone in this distinguished audience. This is Pavan Sukhdev dialing in, president of WWF International, goodwill ambassador to the United Nations Environment Programme, and the founder of GIST Impact, a social enterprise committed to redefining corporate performance. Let me start by thanking and congratulating the organizers. The timing of this event could not be better. It reflects the pace of an ongoing renewal of environmental and climate commitments. It sets a very positive precedent for the increasing recognition and awareness that biodiversity and its loss rank alongside climate change as a huge threat to human well-being, and that these threats must be addressed together to ensure global financial stability. The first point I'd like to make is that we depend on nature, and nature losses pose deep risks to society and the economy, and here's why I think so. Firstly, nature is the foundation of our economies and societies. Everything in the room around you has either been grown in nature or has been mined there. Nearly half the world's GDP, according to the World Economic Forum, almost 44 trillion, depends directly or indirectly on nature. In terms of nature losses, over a decade ago, the G8 Plus Five Commission's report known as TEEB, the Economics of Ecosystems and Biodiversity, which I was privileged to lead, had estimated that we were losing something like $2.5 to $4 trillion of economic value in terms of just the lost ecosystem services annually due to our business as usual policies and practices and the resulting deforestation and forest degradation that was taking place worldwide. And more recently, WWF's Global Futures report shows that maintaining this business as usual approach will contribute to a cumulative loss of GDP of nearly $10 trillion by 2050 from just key biodiversity areas and the six key ecosystem services that they provide. These are staggering sums for us to be losing. But remember, this is just the economic equation. We've seen that biodiversity loss in conjunction with climate change can be a green swan, and it can affect financial stability. And this is clear to many central banks and financial supervisors, and we welcome the acknowledgement in the NGFS Glasgow Declaration of the interconnection between nature loss and climate change, as well as their intention to include cross-cutting issues that relate to conserving and restoring forests and other critical ecosystems, as well as transitioning to a more sustainable agricultural and land use approach. Conversely, I've talked about the risks and the costs. Conversely, there are opportunities. There is tremendous opportunity in pursuing an alternative economic pathway, a so-called inclusive green economy. And recent estimates from the World Economic Forum suggest that a sustainable transition in core sectors, food, land and ocean use, infrastructure, construction, energy and extractives, would need a capital investment of about $2.7 trillion annually, and they could deliver something like $10 trillion in annual business opportunities and almost 400 million jobs by 2030. In other words, improvements in livelihoods and improvements in profits and in the resilience of communities around the world is a very feasible opportunity that sits before us if we get our investment in nature right. Secondly, I'd like to flesh out for you the evidence and the rationale to make the case for investing in nature or natural capital, if you want to use the common economic metaphor, over the long term. So to firstly clarify, what does investing in nature mean? It means naturally investing in the landscapes and the oceans, but it also means investing in food systems, which are all about putting nature to work to provide improved nourishment for all of us, as well as decent work and wages and better profits for farmers. Take the case of investing in nature through the use of forestry, climate mitigation and adaptation. Take the case more widely of how to achieve the same thing, climate mitigation and adaptation, by focusing on investing in food systems. Let's begin by measuring the value chain impacts of today's food systems. An NGO known as Grain suggests that if we look at our food systems on a systemic basis, in other words, cradle to grave, which includes the deforestation that took place in order to be able to grow the soy and the beef and the palm oil to generate our foods, and then accounts for the transportation of these commodities around the world, and then accounts for the food waste, which is almost a third of the food we grow, and the greenhouse gas emissions from that food waste. Food systems collectively, therefore, from cradle to grave, if you like, account for something like 46 to 56% of our total greenhouse gas emissions. So this is obviously a huge lot more than the 23% that we keep referring to as the greenhouse gas emissions of farming. But that's not just the food system. It's the whole value chain we need to think about. In other words, human food systems are the elephant in the drawing room as far as greenhouse gas emissions are concerned. If we want to mitigate climate change, this is where we should start. And please note that if we were to achieve that through agroecological means and through ways of improving smallholder farms, that means increased income and farm profits for over a billion smallholder farmers. So it's actually an adaptation measure because it is enabling those who are the most susceptible to climate change, which is smallholder farmers, especially those in coastal areas, to actually protect themselves from the ravages of storms, cyclones, floods, droughts, everything that happens with climate change. And not only that, but by transforming agriculture using macroecological and natural farming techniques, it's been demonstrated to generate considerable benefits even in water saving as well, a saving which will be especially valuable as an adaptation measure when climate change is disrupting and shrinking water supplies all around the world. But I would like to caveat that investing in nature is not just a question of applying more financial capital. This is also about political capital, in other words, changes in policy. Policy reforms are absolutely essential and they must go alongside financial investment. This means, for example, that we should focus on the negative externalities of conventional agriculture and manage them down. We must focus on perverse subsidies, which must be disclosed, tracked in a transparent way, and gradually eliminated. Why? Because these subsidies are acting as a brake on the desirable transition, and also because they themselves represent a huge systemic risk. Incorporating externalities in managing at the macro level or at the micro level is really something that is a concern which cannot be denied or delayed. Friends, I must warn you that tomorrow's risks and the day after tomorrow's losses, and indeed, these externalities are the hidden negative alpha, if you like, in many investment portfolios. This is especially true of passive investment, of all the index trackers that are so ubiquitous these days. And this is a truth already understood by some asset managers, and indeed by most private equity GPs. For example, if you were a GP, how well would you like it if in year 8 or 9 of a 10-year horizon in your portfolio, you discover some huge negative externality, which suddenly has become a risk and a loss as a result of some new regulation being imposed, or as a result of some new tax being imposed, or because of some reputational risk that you have incurred? Not exactly the situation you want to be. This truth is gradually seeping into the thinking of corporations, large and small. And they're beginning to realize that investors are looking at performance beyond just profit forecasts. They are looking at imminent risks along the horizon. They're looking at stranded assets. And they're trying to get their heads around the size of investee externalities and the probability of internalization. And friends, make no mistake, corporate externalities can and they do get internalized. Yes, at unpredictable times and in different ways. And these define investment risk, because risk is what can happen to your asset quality and your profit and loss. Internalization of externalities can happen and does happen. It can happen in broadly 3 different ways: by design, by decree, or by disaster. Well, let me begin with the last one, internalization by disaster. Well, that's what happened to BP in the Gulf of Mexico in 2010. Attempt to save costs due to avoiding a certain pressure activated device led to the disaster that you heard about, which then in turn led within a month to wiping off something like $70 billion of market cap for the company, the dismissal of its chief executive officer, and a reputation in tatters. And to this day, more than a decade later, huge fines being incurred by the company through settlements and litigations. And then there can be internalization by decree, which is essentially what happened to the sugar sweetened beverages industry in the UK when some years ago the Chancellor of the Exchequer decided to impose what was called a sugar levy on the grounds that, well, £5.5 billion of National Health Service costs and something like £27 billion worth of productivity losses to the economy were the direct consequence of the amount of money spent and the lost time, essentially disability adjusted life years. As a result of obesity and diabetes, which was being driven, among other things, by excessive sugar consumption. The prices of sugar companies and the sugar sweetened beverages manufacturers definitely took a tumble at that point. And finally, of course, there's what we would want, what I would certainly want, is internalization by design. And this means working in large communities, working with financial regulators, working with central banks, working with accountancy bodies, and seeing what can be done to change our way of measuring corporate performance and motivating and managing the C-suite to include not just profits for shareholders, but also impacts on stakeholders. In other words, to widen the lens of performance to include externalities. This kind of internalization by design would enable markets and give them the opportunity to respond by punishing the misallocation of capital. This kind of internalization by design is what you're seeing already beginning to be worked on by groups, associations like the Value Balancing Alliance, which includes the big 4 accountancy majors, as well as some leading corporations around the world, founded by among others, BASF. And they are working closely with and alongside the EU Transparent Project, which is the European Union initiative, which is also moving in the same direction. The redesign of corporate performance to include impacts on natural, human, and social capital, and the introduction of new reporter and disclosure rules is really a critical piece of the puzzle when we talk about changing the direction of the economy. In other words, reducing the negative externalities that are exposing us to planetary boundary risks around the world. Talking of this, I do see a way forward emerging, and I was totally delighted at the Glasgow COP, there was an announcement of the ISSB, the International Sustainability Standards Board, created by the International Accounting Standards Board. In other words, we have a hope now that just like the IFRS, the International Financial Reporting System of the IASB, is a standardized way of capturing the impacts of a company's operations for a year on its shareholders, you could probably have a standardized way of capturing the impacts of a company on its stakeholders. In other words, opening the gates towards what we sometimes refer to as stakeholder capitalism. I think it's very, very telling that the most important global purveyor of financial accounting standards is now in the business of purveying sustainability standards for the private sector. This is excellent news. Please watch this space, because it will define a fundamental and necessary change in the way that corporate performance is measured and in the ability of society to manage down negative externalities. Remember, 2/3 of the economy is private sector. In the US, 3/4 of GVA and jobs. So the private sector's externality are actually a significant part of the pressure that is driving us towards planetary boundaries. Managing that and controlling that is a huge part of the solution. In his recent report and in his writings for almost 3 decades, Professor Partha Dasgupta has described nature as a capital asset, one which regenerates itself and delivers healthy public returns. In the Dasgupta Review and others, other publications. He compares good managers of natural capital to good portfolio managers. And conversely, bad managers, you might say, by that I mean those who either do not correct for nature's economic invisibility, or those who do not recognize that public good, such as most of what natural capital is, has measurable value, even if it doesn't have a market price. Such bad managers will invariably destroy national wealth for citizens, as surely bad portfolio managers will destroy wealth for private investors. Professor Dasgupta calls to our attention the point that we need to change our economic paradigm and include nature as an ingredient in our decision-making. These are his words. Recognizing that our long-term prosperity relies on rebalancing our demand for nature's goods and services with its capacity to supply them. And friends, I argue that Professor Dasgupta's macroeconomic logic can and must be extended to the microeconomic logic as well. And if we follow through with ISSB, the International Sustainability Standards Board, this is indeed what is going to happen. So the question then is, what will all this do to the economy of the future? What are we looking at? Well, I'm optimistic. I think the economy of the future is beginning to be seen. We saw a recent estimate by the GIN, the Global Impact Investing Network, which estimated that the sustainable agriculture, forestry, and fishery product and ecotourism, carbon credits, biodiversity, water and offset markets, and so on, all of these collectively have a market potential of over $520 billion. The economy of the future will also have a huge amount of emphasis on risk management, because we are facing significant risk, escalating risks, increasingly so with climate change. It will be about energy efficiency. It'll be about renewable energy. It'll be about resource efficiency. Our economic dependencies on nature translate financial gains and losses. And entire businesses are springing up from managing these risks and managing these transitions, from providing data to providing advice and providing transition assistance. This is business. Look at all these companies like MSCI, DNVGL, Sphera, so many others, and look at how well their valuations are rising. The market knows something here. We should be conscious of that, and policymakers should align their thinking towards what is happening here. Another point I'll make in this space of the economy of the future is, look at the profit opportunities. Gains, yes, of course, will come by the efficient use of natural resources, energy efficiency, materials efficiency, but also from avoiding losses, avoiding the imposts and the social costs that are related to unsustainable practices, and avoiding the internalization of those social costs. And other gains will come from what we now call nature-based solutions, for improving carbon capture and storage, for improving farm productivity, improving water quality, improving storm and cyclone protection, and so on. Output globally will undoubtedly suffer from climate breakdown, make no mistake, but adding such services, the risk management kind, materials efficiency, et cetera, adding these services will restore productivity and can revitalize the economy of the future. You might ask, so, okay, what should we do today? What do we need to do? Well, yes, we need commitments, but these are, of course, necessary, but they're not sufficient. In order to scale these investment opportunities, voluntary actions alone will not be enough. We must welcome the commitments undertaken by GFANZ, the Glasgow Finance Alliance for Net Zero, which is over 450 financial institutions representing over 130 trillion in capital to deliver a net zero economy by 2050. But we must also acknowledge that according to the latest CDP report, less than 1% of $27 trillion of global fund assets today are aligned actually with the goals of the Paris Agreement. Voluntary commitments, therefore, will not be enough for nature either, right? So we do need regulatory intervention. We clearly need the intervention of regulators, supervisors, central banks to ensure that the financial sector fully plays its part in supporting a net zero and a nature positive transition. And even though data, tools, and methodologies are rapidly developing and will soon be more widely available to enable more accurate assessment of risk from environmental degradation, waiting for perfect data and methodologies should not be the excuse for inaction. Regulators need to make good judgment calls on sufficient data, and I argue that today, sufficient data is already available. Another point I'd make in this vein is that we must really start taking climate and biodiversity together. I'm hopeful that a turning point has been reached in a sort of mainstream acknowledgement that climate change and biodiversity matter and that these two issues have to be tackled hand in hand. There's plenty of evidence. There's the interim report of the NGFS, Inspire Study Group on Biodiversity. There's the fact that the G20 Sustainable Finance Working Group roadmap intends to expand beyond climate and include nature and biodiversity in its scope. Commitments to end deforestation have been made, and increasing investments in nature-based solutions during the recent COP26. And last but not the least, the launch of TNFD, the Task Force for Nature-Related Financial Disclosures, mirroring the Task Force for Climate-Related Financial Disclosures, but expanding the envelope of disclosure and of risk that a company takes and a financial institution takes in the process of lending and issuing debt and equity and so on. Meanwhile, there are tools that financial regulators and policymakers can already consider in the directions that we are talking about here. I'll just enumerate a few of them. So I would recommend that they encourage the disclosure of nature risks and impacts, such as I just mentioned, the TNFD. You cannot manage what you do not measure, and having a better view of the pressure points in any supply chain is necessary. And this requires a common framework. TCFD provided one on the climate side. TNFD hopefully will provide that towards nature. And as I mentioned recently, the International Sustainability Standards Board will enable us to start assessing and reporting this data down to the corporate level in a standardized manner. Geospatial data included. So there's a lot here that is available and can be. Secondly, I'd say that assessing the exposure of financial actors under the supervision of authorities to biodiversity loss, as some central banks have already done, such as DNB, Banque de France, to understand and show the systemic impact of biodiversity loss on the real economy is an action point that needs to be taken. Again, tools are available here. Third, developing science-based taxonomies is already happening. The EU taxonomy is a case in point. They will positively contribute to nature to signal to investors where efforts should be directed and will hopefully also encourage companies to set themselves science-based targets for nature, SBTN, a bit like science-based targets, which are already voluntary, and many companies around the world, leading companies in the space of sustainability, are already taking this approach seriously. Fourth, I think we should recognize that investments in natural capital are most urgently needed in emerging markets and economies, and we must try and align the mandates of the international financial institutions with the post-2020 global biodiversity framework and mobilize private finance through blended finance mechanisms in these markets and the economies. Using public funds better by redirecting harmful subsidies towards nature-positive and socially inclusive alternatives and activities is a no-brainer. And reversing nature loss, and has been calculated and recalculated many times, does make economic sense. Reversing nature loss could cost us $1 trillion a year, but that's less than 1% of annual GDP and is just a fraction of the $5 trillion plus annual cost today of subsidizing fossil fuels. Finally, I'd say, let's look at monetary policies as well as part of the toolkit. They can support a nature-positive economy using monetary policy operations such as asset purchase programs and targeted financing, refinancing operations, adaptation of a collateral framework to integrate environmental risks. And central banks have a key role to play, leading by example when managing their own portfolio and sending the right incentives to financial market actors using, for example, forward guidance, right? Frank Ellison's speech explaining what the ECB will do on banking supervision in the coming months and how targets need to be translated into milestones. Such guidance is pushing financial institutions to prepare for the upcoming changes in supervision and regulation. So, to conclude, I would like once again to congratulate the organizers of the event, that is Banco de Mexico and SEMLA, that's the Center for Latin American Monetary Studies, for successfully bringing together experts to address difficult questions and to take on a challenge that goes way beyond the narrow view of a central bank's mandate just to ensure financial stability, but instead embraces the idea that no economic prosperity is possible without a holistic view of risk or without recognizing and responding to the importance. I have no doubt that the financial system and its supervisors and regulators have a major role to play in conserving this public wealth for future generations and for time to come. Thank you.